Anyway, next speaker, let me introduce Dr. Harini Amarasuriya from Open University, of the Department of Social Studies, and she is a member of the Open University Teachers Association, and she's going to talk to you about the most timely topic, I guess, what is free education. Harini, it's all yours.
ස්තුතියි තිරිනා සිරු දෙනාගේම අවසරයි මම පටන් ගන්න පොඩි පාපොච්චාරණයකින් එකක් මම මේ ඔව් නෑ ඊට ඉස්සෙල්ලා මම කියන්න ඕනේ මහේෂ් කිව්වා අර ප්‍රොෆෙසර් උයන්ගොඩ කිව්වා වගේම කිසිම පැකිලීමකින් තොරව මේක බාරගත්තක සම්පූර්ණ බොරු මේ මොකෝ මට මේක කියපු ගමන් සහ මේ මාතෘකාව කියපු ගමන් මං කිව්වා මහේෂ් ඔගොල්ලෝ හදාන්නේ මාව වට කරගෙන ගහන්න නේද කියලා මේ මාව සෙට් කරලා තියෙන්නේ මාතෘකාවම දැක්කම ඉතින් බොහොම පැකිලීමකින් මේකට එකඟ වුණේ පැකිලීමකින් තොරව නෙවෙයි අනිත් එක මං කියන්න ඕනේ මේ මම මේ කතාවට සූදානම් වෙද්දි මම ඉතාමත්ම මෙතෝඩිකලි මගේ නෝට්ස් ගහගෙන ආවා ඒ නෝට්ස් ගෙනල්ලත් නැහැ සහ මම හිතන් හිටියේ මේ මේක මේ සාකච්ඡාව යන්නේ ඉංග්‍රීසි භාෂාවෙන් කියලා මම ඒක නිසා දැස්ති උනේ ඉංග්‍රීසි භාෂාවෙන් කතා කරන්න so with your permission I'm going to speak mainly in the English language so the topic that I have been given is what is free education and when I got this topic I was actually quite surprised Because why 72 years later, after free education was introduced to this country and implemented, we are still asking the question, what is free education? So I thought I should go to the source document here, and because I've been spending some time recently looking at the history of free education, I actually have been reading the Karnangara Committee report of 1945 with a lot of interest. And in the Karnangara report, which I have forgotten to bring today, or which I have lost somewhere between the Open University and Colombo University, on page 65, there are 2.5 pages under the title, What is Free Education? Only 2.5 pages compared to the rest of the document. And in the 2.5 pages, what is said, if I remember correctly, is it starts with the phrase that any democratic society, that no one should be surprised at the fact that any democratic society should be able to provide equal opportunities in education, right? And it is very clear that what they meant at the time by free education was that education should be free of cost to the recipients of education. And it says also that from primary to university level, education should be free in Sri Lanka, and that is what they propose. Now, there are a couple of really interesting things about the Karnangara report when you read it closely. One is that there's a lot of emphasis in the report on the link between education and equality, equal opportunities for education, and also the link between education and democracy. So repeatedly the report refers to the fact that the reason for the education reforms is to provide equal opportunities to all and that socioeconomic circumstances, they specifically mention this, that socioeconomic opportunities should not be a barrier to accessing good quality education. And secondly, it constantly talks about the link between democracy and education, and also talks of the fact that as a country that is at the sort of cusp of gaining independence, the way in which the education system is formulated is actually very critical for the future of the country and for citizenship particularly. Now, what is also very interesting in this report, if you sort of also look at some of the other documents and the dissent around this, the whole free education debate, is that, as most of you know, this was not a report that was passed easily. Some of the discussions started around the 1930s, yet it took a really long time for this to be actually brought to the stage of where it could be actually presented as a committee report. It is well known that the Prime Minister, Sir D.S. Senanayake, was strongly opposed to the idea of free education. And in the report itself, not everybody agreed with all the recommendations. There are dissenting voices, and the dissenting statements are included in the report. Now, even more interestingly, at this time, the LSSP members of the political party members, many of them were imprisoned at the time, because this was, I think, their resistance to World War II, that whole issue, and most of the LSSP leaders were in prison, so they could not participate in this whole debate. But Dr. N.M. Pereira, while in prison, I think, he wrote something on the LSSP position on free education. And in this document, there's something very interesting, which actually I also didn't know, and when I went back to the committee report, I realized this was correct. The initial recommendation of the committee was that free education should only be for the years of compulsory education, up to grade 8, because there was such a lot of opposition to the idea of free education. It was actually when the report was due to be signed, on the day that the committee met to sign the report, that a member for the Dumbara area, Mr. A. Ratnayake, who was at the meeting, strongly fought for the inclusion, that education should be free throughout, from primary to university level. And also because Karnangara strongly supported this position, on that day this decision was changed. And the proposal that education should be free from primary to university was based on this intervention by Mr. Ratnayake, who none of us are really even familiar with, right? Now, so in the dissenting section of the report, Ivor Jennings, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Ceylon, says he is in favor of this idea of free education, but he is critical of the fact that it was rushed through, that the discussion was rushed through, and that the report only has 2.5 pages actually describing what free education means. He thinks that there should be more detail. Karnangara is strongly in favor of this. And there's a strong dissent from, I think, the warden of St. Thomas's, Reverend Disera, who says he's completely opposed to this idea of free education, that the original idea that it should be up to grade 8 should have been the position of the committee. Now, also, what is interesting in this report is that a lot of discussion, a lot of the space is taken to introducing a new system of education, a new structure. So education, they proposed, this was never implemented, but that the education structure should be divided as to primary, practical schools, and secondary schools. And that there should be a sort of filtering of students from the beginning towards more sort of practical, technical training and to more academic training. Now, once again, this was strongly critiqued by N.M. Pereira, who felt that this was once sort of, you know, going to mean, going to sort of mean that only a certain type of student would be able to proceed to the kind of more academic school. Ivor Jennings is also critical of this. Karnangara is somewhat neutral, but the other members of this the committee are strongly in favor of such a system. So what actually then, also in the preface to the document, Mr. Karnangara says that the final document was a result of heavy compromise, right? He acknowledges this at the beginning, and it's very clear that the sections of the report don't really are often contradictory and don't really sort of make sense if you take it as a whole. Some of the principles are contradicted from the recommendations itself. So, for example, although this idea of equal opportunity and that education, the quality of education, that this should be the same for all, the committee does not recommend any change in the actual system of education. So the non-denominational schools, which is where the whole sort of argument about privilege type of education for certain groups in society comes about, non-denominational schools are allowed to continue. There's no difference, no mention of any changes to the medium of instruction or any other changes. The only thing that happens is that schools that do not get state fund, no, schools that receive state funding hereafter are to be free, completely free. Now, in reality, it didn't change things to a great extent, because as it was, the sort of vernacular schools teaching in the Sinhala and Tamil language were anyway free of charge. They did not charge fees. And what this meant was that the few state-supported schools that were teaching in the English medium became accessible to all. Right. So the sort of structural changes that are promised or sort of imagined in some of the more lofty ideals of the committee report are not really followed through in the actual recommendations. Now, I'm actually very interested in that, in this aspect, how there's this such a lot of contradiction in this report and in the promise of free education. Also the sort of the change in the medium of instruction and the takeover of the school only happens later in the 1950s with the introduction of the change in language policy, national language policy, and also the school takeover that happened in the 1950s. And of course, by this time, the arguments had become much more sort of based on a kind of a nationalist, particularly a sort of a Sinhala nationalist kind of ideology. So that was what drove those changes that took place at that particular time, rather than the sort of more sort of idealized vision of democracy and citizenship that Karnangara's report emphasizes. So what this actually does is that it enabled in our school education system is that it provided for means for individual mobility, right? Without really any challenge to the existing system of power relations or class relations in society. I mean, it allowed for the kind of, for individuals to emerge through this system, but whether it actually kind of challenged any of the structural inequalities in societies up for discussion and debate. So for those of us who are familiar with sort of the sociology of education, this is not something very surprising. Education has been in sociology, in sociological theories, often talked about as a social institution which is there for the purpose of social control and also for the reproduction of a system of relations in a society. Right? Now, I would like to actually suggest that the Sri Lankan situation with regard to education provides us with an excellent example of how this has happened. Right, and the fact that from the beginning, the sort of notion of free education has been such a site of sort of dissent, debate, and violence, sort of also reflects to me the kind of the system of relations and the system of sort of the way in which power actually has existed and worked in our society. And I would actually like to propose that more of us are engaged in more analysis and studies of the way in which class relations and social relations have been reproduced through our education system. Now, theories of education, of sociology of education, also acknowledge the fact that education systems do facilitate this kind of individual mobility, but what happens in this through this individual mobility is also that what is actually happening is that those who are able to move forward are trained and reproduced in a kind of a, through a system of what is referred to as a sort of an arbitrary cultural system, which is actually based on a system of power. That means that what happens through the education system is that you are trained, or your disposition is trained to adhere to the cultural system of the dominant class. So those who emerge out of this free education system ultimately are there to follow the sort of cultural aspirations and the cultural ideas, the dominant cultural ideas of the dominant class, and this doesn't in any way challenge the system of relations or power that exist in society. And I think our system of education is a classic example of this and how this has happened. And in many ways, the fact that many of us who even acknowledge the need for education reform articulate this reform in terms of sort of technical interventions that are necessary to improve education takes that debate away from the very real structural issues and the structural problems of our education system. So for example, when all of us talk about education reform, we are sort of bogged down in the idea of the relationship between education and employability, right? The medium of instruction, what it should be, right? I suggest that in a way these serve as distractions to the actual structural inequality that our education system contributes to maintaining. Now, it is also very interesting that in this system of education that we are currently experiencing, any reforms that sort of were brought about within a nationalist agenda, even in changes of curriculum, have passed with little resistance. If you look at the curriculum, particularly of the school system, you can see the way in which the curricula also sort of promotes and encourages a real ethnic polarization, right? And is actually antithetical to any ideas of reconciliation or democracy or any of those. Those kinds of reforms have gone through with little resistance, either by the dominant classes or by any other class, right? But any efforts at actually sort of main questioning or challenging the structural inequalities within the system are met with heavy, heavy resistance and often state violence. And I know that many of us here have our disagreements with the students and the way in which they do engage in student politics. But in a way, I think what is happening with the students and the kind of tensions that we have seen in the education system is a reflection of this very sort of institutionalized inequality that we find within our education system. So, in a way, I think that this battle that we are constantly in for free education, to the point that even today, more than 70 years later, we, the university community, is asking ourselves, what is free education? Is actually also about a battle for power. It's a political and ideological battle that we are engaged in. And I think the fact that we do not acknowledge this is part of the problem. That this is some kind of a technical problem that can be resolved through change in curricula, change in admission criteria, introduction of English classes, orientation for students, that this is how we fix the problem of education, I think highlights the extent to which we have sort of ignored the political and ideological battle that is at the base of this battle for free education. So in a way, I'm going to be a little provocative here, but in a way, I think our position, our own position with regard to free education, in many ways, may sort of reflect whether we are complicit or not in maintaining the system of class relations that have existed in our society for so long, for which we are still paying, and to what extent we are complicit also in maintaining the interests of the dominant class in our society. And I think unless we are sort of ready to kind of confront that very political and very ideological debate on what free education means for Sri Lanka, we are sort of, you know, just engaging in sort of little sort of adjustments to a system that has actually contributed to maintaining some of the most unfortunate aspects of our society. And I think Professor Uyangoda's presentation about what this new model also proposes, and who, if we look at who is actually in favor of such models, again it shows the kinds of the sort of class and social divisions in our society which we have really failed to engage with. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harini. I didn't have to drag you off the stage, so I was about to come up. You just finished that right on time. Let me make a small announcement. And since we had two speakers now, we had two more speakers to go. If you want to have a drink of water, we have the water dispensers on either side. Please feel free to come and get a drink of water. It's free with the education. before I get the next speaker up here, this is just ara mata tiyana unata mam me kathawa ahana kota liya ganna dewal walin poddak kiyanne. I think Harini was basically the way, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, Harini. What you said was the free education means then it's a way to stop the individual intellectual development and get everybody through a mill and produce a certain product, have a certain product so that it can be used. I don't know whether that is a proper analysis of what you said. That's the way I understood it. That means, you know, if you know this is free, why go for other places when you have this free? So come and get it, and once you get it, of course, you don't know what will happen, and we know what will happen because we know what is going to come out.